Hi there, and thank you for joining us for the 12:30 presentation on composting. I am your MC for the discussion, Shango Los. I am the host of the Shaping Fire podcast. If you enjoy learning from the top minds in the cannabis industry, I encourage you to visit shapingfire.com to enjoy in-depth interviews on cannabis business, health, and technique that will provide you with actionable information and will not waste your time. Recent guests of the show included cultivator Kevin Jodry, the godfather of cannabis terpenes neurologist Dr. Ethan Russo, geneticist Dr. Reggie Gaudino on cannabis plant patents, cannabis breeder Mean Gene from Mendocino, and Natasha Riz on using the cannabis root ball as medicine, and many, many other folks. So postcards for the podcast are available at the entry in case you've already forgotten shapingfire.com. Also, if you want to share this presentation with others who are not here today, a video of this presentation will appear on my YouTube channel next week. You can find that channel at youtube.com/ShangoLos. And if that name seems hard to remember, that's also on the postcard at the entry. Colum Riley is co-founder of Malibu Compost. He's a member of the U.S. Compost Council, Biodynamic Compost Council, and one of the most innovative composters in the world. He drives all farm production for Malibu Compost. Today, Colum is going to be talking about biodynamic living soils. Please put your phones on vibrate if you haven't already done so, and please hold your questions till the end. Let's offer Colum a well-armed welcome.
Thanks, Shango. All right, good morning. How's everybody doing?
Woo-hoo!
It's technically afternoon, but I'm sure it still feels like morning because it's Sunday. Thank you guys so much for coming out. I just wanted to talk a little bit about biodynamic agriculture, specifically composting, kind of how that fits into a regenerative approach to cannabis cultivation and agriculture in general. Definitely have plenty of time for questions. First, wanted to thank Erica Edwards, aka the Stone Pixie, for this photo on the front. This is cannabis grown in cubicle culture approach inside in a greenhouse at Alpenglow Farms in Humboldt County. You can see all the companion planting in the front. So just want to talk a little bit about what it is that we do, our farm, sort of a production approach, talk a little bit about the soils, some different ideas about biodynamic approaches or perspectives, how that fits into the larger discussion, and go from there. First of all, how many people here are familiar with biodynamic? All right, so we got a couple. Essentially, biodynamic comes from the root bio and dynos, which is this idea of life and force, and that in everything around us, and especially in agriculture, things work on this biological level with this biological intelligence and biological factors. And there's also the dynamic side. These are sort of like the energies and the rhythms that we see in agriculture, whether it's sap running through the trees, the things we see associated with full moons, gravitational pulls. This affects the depth that water goes when you irrigate or water. But basically that interrelationship between sort of the dynamic approach to agriculture and the biological approach and how these kind of synthesize. So we make compost two locations. This is just a shot of our windrows in Oregon, which isn't as clear with this, but and then our farm in California, which is where we first started about 8 or 9 years ago. And our kind of approach was to try and identify how we could make the best soil, so to speak. How can we make the best compost known to man, put it in a bag, and really try to sort of bring the farm to you and take all the values of what one would want in an ethical, truly organic and beyond organic type of operation, but be able to make that available to people who don't, you know, have cows walking around the front yard or backyard. So this is Boo, our spokes cow. We adopted a cow for a couple of reasons. One, because we make our manure from cows. And there's a number of reasons for that, but it has to do with organic grass-fed pasture-raised cows have this 12-day digestive cycle. So from the time that that mother cow starts eating and chomping on grass, it takes 12 days for those enzymes. And essentially, cows are a giant fermentation vessel. They are a ruminator. They are a fertility. And I always say that, you know, we often call it a dairy cow because we've put the highest monetary value on what milk is. But if a pound of compost were worth more than a pound of milk, milk is a byproduct, but you know, it's a poop cow. And you know, that's the difference between that. Anyhow, we adopted that. The second reason was the year we started our company, 2009. The prior year, there was 5 dairy farmer suicides in Fresno County, California alone. And this stemmed from a lot of factors, but one is the economic factors, that when the prices keep going up and people aren't willing to pay as much for the supply, it becomes unfeasible for people to farm. Other generations don't want to go through the struggles they're seeing their parents face, and more we see farmers, and these are some of the proudest people, dairy farmers, and it just, you know, to see this at the same time that there's such a value to what cows can produce, we kind of wanted to bring attention to the role that farmers play, that farms play, and of course, cow play. So, little side note there, but if you wonder why everything comes back to boo, that's why. So this is quickly the poop loop. The cows are eating on grass, and it's grass here, and our Oregon farms come from Oregon cows, and the California farms come from California cows. Why does this play an important role? Well, if you guys stick around for Jeff Lowenfeld's presentation at 1:30, he'll talk a lot more about microorganisms, indigenous beneficial bacteria and fungi. And if you go out and you're familiar with the role that mycorrhizae plays in the soil and the root system and the plant health, there are indigenous naturally occurring mycorrhizae that happen. And it happens through this fermentation process, through the cow manure. And when we compost that cow manure, the same profile of beneficial microorganisms that are found in California are found in our compost, because there's a symbiotic relationship between grasses and animals. And if anybody's familiar, and this is another side note, I do a lot of this, so we'll have time for questions, but how many people here are familiar with John Wick and the Marin Carbon Project? Nobody. Okay. Total side note, but this guy right up the road, maybe 30 miles from here, is the subject of some of the most cutting edge research in the world on carbon sequestration. And what they found is, he saw the degradation of the pastures. Software guy bought a bunch of acreage up in Marin, and somebody grazed it for the summer, some cows came through, there were all these annuals and perennials and local grasses, the cows left and all these thistles came and the grass looked like shit. And literally, and so he wanted to look at what was this role, and the soils were gradually getting worse and worse and depleted the carbon. And so he teamed up with a soil ecologist, Jeff Creek, and they did this research and did a lot of control plots. I'm selling them short, but quick abbreviated thing is, they decided in one of the control plots to put down an application of compost on the hillside to try to simulate range animals coming through and pooping all over the land and eating the grasses. And he rented a herd of cows for the summer and pastured it there. And what he noticed was all these annuals and perennials came back. They stomped out this. The carbon cycle that happened was just incredible. And when he gave them back, when he gave these cows back to the farmer, they had collectively, the whole herd collectively, had gained 5,000 pounds. So where does this 5,000 pounds come from? Well, it came from this whole cycle of grass and adding more through the nutrients and through the fertility and through the carbon sequestration and what it's pulling out of the atmosphere. So to simulate this, they added us one application of compost the first year and then didn't even do it the following year. So what they noticed is, not only was this trend of depleted soils halted, but the soils started regenerating themselves year after year after year, even out without putting more compost down. Total tangent, we're getting off on a side thing, but these are all important, because when you hear what is carbon sequestration, you need to think about taking organic matter. I tell people here, if you're a farmer, if you're doing cannabis in Humboldt or Mendocino or anywhere else, if you're collecting woody biomass, track it. You might not get the carbon credits right now, you might not be getting it, but all these different bills are taking place in Sacramento that are gonna allow for benefits for removing woody undergrowth. It's free carbon storage for you. You're putting it back in the soil, and there's going to be an economic benefit to it down the future. And if not, you're able to tell people about what you're doing on your farm and your carbon footprint. Are you carbon neutral? So, Quick poop loop. Cows are eating the grass. Now we know why. We're taking the manure, we're scooping it up, bring it across the road, pile it up, and we use a natural windrow system. We want thermophilic composting. I want the compost to exceed 133 degrees, but not exceed 160. Why? At 133 and above, you get pathogen reduction. It starts killing off the weed seeds, the E. coli, the salmonella, everything else like that. We track the temperatures, of course, because this has to do with airflow, has to do with carbon-nitrogen ratio, has to do with the moisture in the pile or lack thereof. So basically, it's the four variables. Earth, water, air, and fire is how you build your compost recipes. At 160 degrees, a lot of the beneficial microorganisms start getting killed off. So a lot of composting places build really big piles, get them really hot really quickly to kill off the pathogens, and then try to just put them in a bag and sell them or tote them up or get them out the door. They've killed off. They heat it to a 180 or 190 because they get quicker throughput, but you've lost a lot of the living microbiology. You'll get a bunch of nutrients out of it, some plants will love it, you know, but you're not getting the same kind of diverse approach to build your soil food web. We use a windrow turning system to get the homogeneity. It just essentially turns the pile inside out. We want to avoid the anaerobic core in the middle. You just do this with a pitchfork or a skid steer, depending on the size and scope of your own compost operation. Then we put biodynamic inoculants in the pile and leave it unturned, which is when some weed seeds like to blow around. So every once in a while, people are like, I found weeds in your compost. Yeah, it happens on a farm. This is when I get mad, is when they pull them out and they got roots like that, because I feel like they're robbing my nitrogen. So if a pile, I can't get to it and it gets wet and it gets over weedy, I will actually just turn all the weeds into the pile, add fresh manure, sort of recycle it, because I want the nitrogen back. But it's just interesting to see like one little thing above and beyond this, you know, below the surface and what you can see. Another little shot of the windrow turner. We put piles at least 30 days for a curing phase. This is compost, much like wine or something else. There's a stability and a maturity. Also, that ammonia smell converts to plant available nitrogen. But we're wanting a diverse, microbiologically active and alive soil, not looking for the hot nitrogen kick that'll get really quickly. So how do people use it? They mix it up, top dress, make compost teas, rebuild your soil. Erosion concerns, compost burns do wonders, and people use it to inoculate generating your on-site compost. So first thing, you are what you eat, whether you're a plant or a human being, and not all compost and soils are created equal. These are a lot of your ag inputs. The feedlot cattle, you know, when you see steer manure, no, you know that's not organic. Why? Because if steer, male cows, are organic, they're called grass-fed. Means they're running around in the field and nobody's following with a pooper scooper like they do in Central Park with the horses, right? So the only thing you're getting there, steer manure, is locked up like this. And it's just a reflection of their living conditions and their feed. Interestingly enough, some of these feedlots are so bad that they take chicken manure, pelletize it, feed it to cows who are natural herbivores, and then wonder why we get mad cow disease. Conventional ags, it's not so much just the chicken manure, okay? But there's just something you should know, and then you make your own judgments, but you may find a compost that's listed as OMRI certified organic. And when they want to rotate these chickens through, they put them in a container and they gas them in a chamber, probably about 10,000 chickens at a time. That's just how they sort of retire the chickens. And then those 10,000 dead chickens are fed through a like a bark shredder and thrown in a compost pile mixed with some casino food waste. And you buy it as certified organic compost. And then you wonder why your cannabis fails the sampling tests. Because those gases used to kill the chickens persist through the entire soil cycle, cannabis cycle, testing cycle. Green waste, recycled inputs. If it's in the compost, it just doesn't magically come out. Same thing that you see, I always get a kick out of the fact, you know, with these guys running through hazmat suits and, you know, selling it to us. So just know your feedstocks, know how, you know, things are separated or not and what the contaminants are. Temperature is always an important thing. You should be looking for a thermophilic compost. It's a big difference between something in California that's labeled as composted versus something you find somewhere else that might not call it compost, but they call it composted. Or they call it aged. The aged manure is something just old shit that was put in a pile and just left. And some breaks down, some doesn't, but there's not a presence of oxygen. It hasn't been managed. So again, if it hasn't been managed, if it's had a lot of anaerobic activity, you're gonna find a lot of harmful microorganisms the same way you'll find beneficials. And it's your gamble in terms of what, you know, outweighs what. Moisture, you want something that starts not too wet, not too dry. Anybody here building their own soils, your own compost? Okay, moisture, you want it, you know, just something where you can't, it's not so wet that it squeezes out of your hand, but not so dry that the dust just falls off your hand to get a good finished pile. Sometimes in the summer, it's good to use micro sprinklers or wet material to add to your pile. Not too dry, and you want a good mix of your feedstocks to begin with. And I always say one of your approaches should be, what do you have the most of around you, and then build your recipe from there. And then how much time? Two things here. Time is important based on the quality of compost you make. The other factor for those of you making your own soil is how much time do you have to devote to it? If you want to devote a lot of time, pick a method of composting which is based around how much time you have and equipment. So if you got time and you got equipment, go for aerated piles. So you're rotating your piles, you're turning them, you're taking your temperatures. You want something that goes through a thermophilic process. You can build the pile that way and then let it go to maturity and start another pile. If you don't have a lot of time or space, build your pile accordingly. You do what's called a static thermophilic pile, where you're gonna pile a bunch of stuff up and leave it. So, if a compost pile breathes from the bottom and goes up, you need to add for air, compensate for airflow on the bottom. So either build it on top of pallets, add a bunch of sticks on the bottom of your pile, and then build your pile on top of that. You can pull the sticks out later. Your goal is not to get those sticks to turn into beautiful, crumbly compost. Your goal is the sticks allow for porosity in the pile and airflow throughout it so everybody else can work. Okay, so your mesophilic bacteria are breaking down everything. Composting a lot happens on the surface area, so you want to have a good amount of surface area. Not too much, because then your bulk density doesn't allow it to breathe, but enough. Good composting techniques, you can sometimes rent a chipper. Sometimes if you have enough woody biomass, one day renting it from your local rental place makes a whole lot of sense. Smaller piles, you can use methodologies where you stick straw or things. Use a 55-gallon drum and a weed whacker with a blade on it and put your material in there and put the weed whacker in and chop it all up. Now you've broken up a lot of that material and you've made it more readily available for breakdown. So there's a lot of kind of home techniques that you can use for your own composting, but I'll let the maestro Jeff Lowenfels come and talk about this. But if you're doing your own composting, pay attention to this. It's going to be fun to look at your pile, kind of see what you have going through it, but understand the role that the soil food web plays in your composting. And when you start seeing this, you start looking at the process differently. A lot of people who have those composting drums, and this is typically for home gardeners because somebody got them to buy one of the drums, and it's always wet and sludgy and they can't figure it out because they're always putting new wet stuff on top of old compost. If you've got a one pallet system at home and you keep piling and adding and adding and adding, it'll never fully finish if you keep adding to it. So easy thing then is build a two or three system. You can just do it out of pallets and string them together. You can just use a simple carabiner in the front to open up the pallet and get to your pile and turn it. Start one and turn it, and then when it gets to a certain height, start your next pile. General rule of thumb, home composters, is for thermophilic composting to occur, you need at least 1 cubic yard of mass. 3 foot by 3 foot by 3 foot. So if anybody's doing home composting, just think about that in the backyard. You need at least that much mass to have enough for temperatures to occur. So in biodynamics, we really kind of look at this as ideal as this closed loop system where everything's generated on site and nothing else leaves the farm and everything flows together. And that's kind of the ideal in biodynamic and regenerative agriculture and permaculture and ecological design. But it's an ideal and we do what we can. So what are some of these factors to consider? Jeff, how are you?
How are you?
You ever heard of the soil food web?
Hey, where'd you get that slide?
I don't know where it came from. But you'll be learning more about it. So, a couple of these things in striving for building good organic soil is understand what your limitations are and work throughout them. So what are you gonna be growing? Are you doing strictly cannabis? Are you doing mixed crops? If you're doing cannabis, could you grow some mixed crops? Do you have ideas? Could you do companion planting? If you're doing other crops, how do you want to integrate it? What do you want to plant close to one another? Work with your climate. Different strains have different characteristics. How long is it going to take to flowering from start to finish? What's the different conditions that are going to happen? You know, these are a lot of, especially here in the Bay Area. The Bay Area is completely comprised of microclimates. If you're growing outdoors, what's the sun arc? What is the airflow? Where's fences in the backyard? What's the traffic situation? And by that I mean foot traffic. Is there a pet path that take place? What's the little ecological system that you have within your own sort of yard or growing situation, and how can you integrate things? So if you're doing it in ground, or you're doing raised beds, fabric pots, do you have a greenhouse, are you doing different coverages? And why are you doing it? Basically, what you want out of it will determine a lot of your strategies going into it. And you want to do the most ecologically responsible thing, but always be aware of what are your limitations in terms of design, equipment, space, considerations, and time. So the nature's role in the garden, the rain, you know, it flushes nutrients. How is your design? Or could you do terracing if you're on a slope? Could you add where one nutrients are going to flush and rebuild another area? Everything you're doing this year should already give you an idea of what you're doing next year. Are you going to plant in the same place next year? If nutrients are washing downhill, can you design something this year so you could plant there next year and harvest those nutrients for an entire year? Build your own biomass. Cold, are there different patches? Understanding the role that temperature plays in your soil and plants, or getting too hot for that matter. The sun, these are just another factors of those different things and airflow and what's your soil. Anybody who grows without a soil test, it boggles my mind. You know, and this comes in this, I'm in the soil industry, a package of soil. And somebody wants to sue you for damaging $40,000 worth of crops on a $4,000 purchase because they didn't spend 40 bucks on a soil test. The math is mind-boggling, so understand the value of a soil test. It just lets you know what you're starting with. Compost teas is another big thing. We use those for top dressing. We use those for teas. Backpack sprayers are great. I'm not a huge fan of certain types of sprayers and brewers. You have to understand there's a relationship between the microbiology and the amount of time that you brew and the force and pounds per square inch that go through, because you're dealing with living products. And I'm not a scientist, but I think the airflow that's required to pump through a 1,000-gallon compost tea brewer would be too high a PSI to allow all the microbes to survive. I'm also a huge fan of applying compost teas within 24 hours, because if you build your compost tea recipe to have as much diversity, you're going after diversity, not necessarily reproduction. And when you start introducing food sources to go beyond 24 hours, you're now introducing competition or exclusion, or maybe some microbes aren't just fond of molasses, even if it is organic hybrid molasses. I'm not a huge fan of molasses, right? So you already, some of that diversity can be left. And I mean, there's a diversity of food sources you can add, but I think it's a different approach. I'm not going to be prescriptive here, but we're a huge fan of building recipes for diversity. We're much more bacterially diverse, so good fungal sources. It's an absolute wonder between, you know, the Malibu and a high-quality worm casting as your base, and then tee it up from there. But drenches and foliars and feeding it weekly at the vegetative growth rate. Drenching is great when you do your transplants. If you can take your plant and kind of dunk the roots and then do your transplant, you're coating it. You're giving a coating with the soil. With microbes. You're adding food sources. You're giving it sort of a comfort zone and an immediate sort of care package, if you will, while it goes and transfers into this new environment and kind of has to figure out where everything is. Foliar feeding is phenomenal, especially if you get powdery mildew outbreaks or things like that. And then discontinuing finally a foliar, especially due to moisture issues. This is a probiotic earth box. It's a different way of growing, using compost and doing top dressing. Soil blends. Are you doing your own blending? Are you recharging soil? Do you have a methodology for your spent soil? Unless, of course, you're doing no-till living organic soil. But it, this boggles my mind. It's one of those things I say, okay, we'll sell you soil, but we need to be cutting your soil bill by like 60% next year. And that should be the thing for everybody. You should have, when people like, grow the soil, dump it out back, grow this. We did it with a microgreens guy. And we're like, all you gotta do, we'll sell you this little thing here and you kind of reboot it. And I know this will take a lot of money out of our pocket, you know, rather sell you truckloads every couple of weeks. But I mean, really, you got this stuff sitting out back and nothing's wrong with it. So, I just love this, you know, but adding worm castings, putting this to your thing, we're gonna build a worm bin and it's gonna be huge. And we're gonna make Monsanto pay for it. A lot of different ingredients that you can put in your compost tea, and these are things to think about between biochar and different inoculations. If you're building your own compost pile, why not put it in the compost pile and upcycle it? Building your own recipes. This is what's funny when a lot of people come to you in this, whether it's in a store or something, but they find something on the internet, they got 117 different amendments, or they're coming with the balanced Albrecht method to you. But oftentimes it's overcomplicated. So start from a simple place that you can understand and go from there. But essentially we love this third of a compost, third of a peat, something to aerate it, and then you can add a couple simple things, you know, add it in. Incorporating your topsoil. Again, there's indigenous microorganisms that are gonna go into that. And understand that it's this living microbes that's taking that place. This is a great way to look at your NPK other than just on a number system. But the compost, the worms, the inoculants, understanding what's in it, you definitely should have some type of an integrated pest management system, even whether you're growing indoor, outdoor. I always like to plug Rincon Vitova. That's one of our go-to sources for beneficials. Available online, they have just millions and millions of things in stock. A little before and after of powdery mildew, and just what a simple compost tea can do, despite the fact that we're not allowed to say that it does anything related to pests or disease. So I can't tell you that compost tea does anything to affect powdery mildew or pests and disease. I can just tell you that sometimes you put it on your plant and the stuff goes away. So thank you definitely for listening. Any questions, we're online. We love to be a resource, especially for home composters, for soil blenders, whether you're building your own thing, whatever your situation is. We do a lot of different events. I've got some free samples up here in the front. You can quickly open the bag or the box, but this is just to make your own compost tea. It's a simple sample here, but I'll throw this up. This is just a place to start, but it's a cotton muslin tea bag. You drop it in a 5-gallon bucket of water, let it soak overnight, and put it on your plants. That's the baseline. I don't say the word aerate, I don't say the word foliar, I don't say the word stomata, that's all like level 2.0. Soil food web nerds would term this a cold water compost tea extract, because it's not technically a brew. But extracts are a phenomenal way to start. And you get a lot of the benefits. Aerators take it up a notch, but compost tea doesn't need to be intimidating. Just start with the absolute simplest approach, integrate that into your practices, and go from there. So, thanks for listening. Any questions?
Yeah, we got time for a couple more, or a couple questions. We have some right away? All right, well then I'll go ahead and take the first one.
Okay.
So I live up in Washington, and when I come down to California for work, I grab Malibu compost and drive it back up with me, right? And so it was really interesting when you said, oh, you know, the microbes are indigenous to where we live, right? Which makes sense.
Yeah.
My question, though, is I bring it back up for small patient grows, not for scalable stuff. Just for people who are, in their heart, they're really probiotic, but they're also sick, so I need to make sure that I set them up as simple as possible.
Yeah.
So the Malibu compost is so alive. What would you say is the potency lasting time where you know a bag could be purchased? Is it still going to be as potent next season, or is it really just like 6 months? Or because certainly it's got to drop off somewhat once it's back.
Sure.
Yeah. So.
And this is a very very great question. And there's a few things there. One is we're talking about the life cycle of microbes. The other is challenges that we face with bagged soils. And the third is your good friends and patients in Washington. Start with the Washington thing is I would say buy Malibu compost in Washington. We'll truck it up there for you. Go to our website. Tell you all the nurseries and garden centers in Washington that it's available. If you're getting it then in Washington or Oregon, it's coming off our Oregon farm. And there's a different microbial profile for those Oregon and Pacific Northwest grasses than there are, you know, California's part of that Mediterranean climate. So there's just, again, different annuals and perennials that they're digesting on a purely microbial level. So get it locally, that way you don't have to drive it as far. It's available, you can set people up, and we just see really, really, and I wish someone else had more money for research to compare our California compost and Oregon compost and look at, you know, how pasture management and, you know, really plays through from one end to the other. Microbial cycle, and people debate a lot about this. You know, everybody says, how much do the microbes die off? And a good portion of microbes go dormant. So there's a dormancy cycle. When they don't get adequate air and moisture, they go dormant. So they're like a bear in hibernation. So this is the idea of then, when you're adding a dried compost, so when we do our tea bags, we take our compost, we lay it out on screens and dry it out. We want the microbes to go to sleep. You know, I don't want to use a heat process because that'll kill them. So let them essentially go dormant. The thing is, if I put Malibu compost in a cotton tea bag, it eats through the cotton because it's a food source and they're still wide awake. So that's the idea, it's kind of dry. When you add it to water, they're all kind of groggy, but they've just got moisture, so they start waking up, and then you add air, and everybody's like got water and air, and then they're ready to just go out and find their own food and just, you know, go to work. In a bag, they're already really, really living. We have challenges. Our biggest thing is people who store the product outdoors over winter, nurseries who mismanage inventory. We always want things to be essentially as fresh as possible, but a vast majority, and I hear anything from die-off occurs between 3% to 23%. I have no idea what it is, but I just know if there's 50 billion living microorganisms in here, and 4 billion of the 50 billion, I got 46 billion living organisms here. I still got a few guys who are gonna do some good work. So it'll, with bag soil, sometimes if someone had something and it sat for a year, we tell them, take it outside, kind of fluff it up, let it sit out in the air and the sun, kind of reawaken and recharge and just get some air and then be able to use it, you know, if it's just kind of gone dormant. So I'll let some of the experts attest to the total die-off of that. And people talk about it with compost teas. Do they start dying at 18 hours? Do they die at 24 hours? How many go dormant? But when you're brewing, you're keeping everybody as alive as possible. When it's in a package, they just sort of, some will die off, but the vast, vast majority are going dormant. Yes, sir?
So, have you done any cystic tests with cannabis plants adding this much compost or no compost side by side to see the effects of plants with amounts of compost as input?
Yes. Largely, a lot of it is anecdotal because we just haven't had the chance to do as many of those different controlled trials as possible. But I've seen people grow in straight compost and the plant grows, but I wouldn't recommend it. It's just too rich. It's just way too many things that are inevitably going to be laid out. If you don't have more than 10% compost in your blend, you're not, anything lower than 10%, you're not really going to gain any of the benefits of compost. And it seems like up to a third of your mix is about kind of that top mark. So I always recommend somewhere between 20 to 30% of a compost blend. Now, if you're using your home compost, it might be different because it might not be 100% broken down and you've got good organic matter that's not broken down, but that can fulfill the function of some type of aeration. So if I build a potting soil, I want 25% compost. Then I'm adding like a blend of peat, cocoa, fir bark chips, right? So you can have replacement for those. Those components might be in your own home unfinished compost, if that makes sense.
So our application would be more big ag, you know, how many tons per acre is effective or not effective? You know, we're talking about spreading it, it's only a quarter inch thick, a quarter inch into the dirt. Is that effective? You know, it's a lot less than 10%.
Oh, now big ag's a completely different question. And part of that has to do with your approach. Are you tilling it in? Are you tilling it into the top of the surface? Are you doing it in conjunction with planting cover crops? Do you do a chop and drop technique? When do you apply the compost? Is it the late fall and when you're letting the rains come in like a vineyard approach does? Quick plug, next weekend in the Presidio is the first international biodynamic wine conference. I'm on a panel there of compost, but there's incredible research going on and what a lot of these regenerative practices are. But there, I hate to say it depends, but a large of it depends on your strategy. And what is your year after year cultivation strategy? So the only answer is, what are you gonna do next year? So you may want to invest in a heavy application this year so you can feed it with a quarter inch application next year. Maybe you'll get to an annual application instead of doing a semi-annual. You find alternative sources. So as that carbon trend starts to turn around, you know, how are you employing cover crops? So I guess that's where it depends. But the idea is you want to import less and less and less material and regenerate as much material as you can on your own land, even if that's growing mass that then can be added back into the soil. Do you have somewhere where all summer long you can start grabbing woody carbonaceous material so you can compost it over the winter? Can you add some of the woody stuff as a sheet that you can add compost on top and a cover crop, let winter break that down for you? You don't have to do the composting. Let it occur at the surface level. Suddenly now all those worms and everything are just feeding off that top mulch layer. In cannabis, that's a great approach because you can use these living top mulch layers and feed from the top down and not have to do this. But that's where I go back to, again, what's your plant? Are you going to plant in the same spot next year? Are you watering? Here's another one. Are you watering in between where you have cannabis planted? Some people like to do the drip irrigation because it's more efficient, but others would say that without irrigating in between the plants, you're losing all the quote-unquote biological intelligence that's available in the soil. And ultimately, watering in between makes everything have higher water holding capacity, greater nutrient availability. The roots can go further. You might want to build, if you're doing a trench system, maybe after 2 years you move the trenches and you take that as pathway and you make this as trench. But maybe then your pathways are becoming mulchways for the first 2 years. So you're building a lot of that mass. So 2 years later, everything's golden. So that's really where this strategy, and it doesn't matter whether it's a backyard or big ag. You know, vineyards, they plant the vine and it just stays. Cannabis, you can pull it out, put another one in. You can rotate it. You know, you can do in-ground. If you're doing fabric pots, you can pile soil around the fabric pots and the roots will go through the pots and you're improving it that much more. So no matter what the situation is, you look at, you know, expanding that and building year after year.
Right, we are out of time. Let's thank Colin Riley from Malibu Compost. Thank you.